Well, hello everybody, welcome back to the next segment of Big Bang Theory Al's BTS vlog. Yeah, let me give it time and date stamp to let you know where we are. It is 15 hours and 39 minutes into the day of Friday, November 4th, 2016. I'm dead tired. I think it's kind of a standard here. When you're doing a lot of research, I did a lot of research last night. I found a good track of information. I mean, there was over I think, maybe 50 pieces of information. And I had to go through each one of them. You go through each one, you sort of see what's there, you take your notes, and then you start comparing your notes. And I actually found some very good stuff. And the thing is that people say, well, how do you find your information? Because I've watched this over and over again, and I can't see anything. As well as, it's, a lot of times, it's not the entire thing. As a matter of fact, times it could be a very tiny bit, like even just a sentence the person says, or the way something says something, that could say, ah, that's how that connects to that. In other words, your connections are not necessarily large things, they're not necessarily obvious. And a lot of times, when you're picking up stuff, when you're picking up information, do you know what you're doing in terms of where you're going to go, where you're going to go for the next bit of information? It says, well, not necessarily. In many cases, it's a wide cast. You cast your net, you pull stuff back in, and see what you have. And it's continuous like that. There's a certain degree of randomness to what you're actually bringing in. And it's in this sort of variety of mess that you bring in. As you sort through it, this is where you begin to find the interesting tidbits, the interesting connections, including so-called New World Order. And the thing is, a lot of people talk about New World Order, and this is talking about this last night on the last episode of Tweetline Plus. This is the one where it's the Tweetline Plus entitled Hillary Clinton, the Real Butcher of Syria. See, a lot of people don't necessarily understand that she's not doing this alone, that she's involved with what they call the New World Order. This is with the UN. This is with a variety of other players that are involved in this. And many of the people who are involved in so-called uncovering the New World Order, or sort of looking at it, always use these very general terms as they and them, and as if the conspiracy is monolithic, but it's not monolithic. Matter of fact, as I said before, you can go down, if you go understand the history of the New World Order, understanding basically it's the socialist utopia. You can actually go in there and actually see the various different groups throughout history that were there in history. Now, we assume that, oh, that history is gone, history is the past, and that's it. Well, no, you can actually find the groups that are involved in the New World Order, so-called New World Order, in history. They're historical. They're not necessarily new and modern. They're historical. So you can actually go back and find a history. And well, what do you see in history? You see that they never achieve what they set out to achieve. There's always internal struggles. Nobody in the New World Order is on the same page. If they can go get something extra for themselves, they will. And this forms a lot of conflict. A lot of the conflict spills over because someone did something that was unplanned. That was, you know, they get together at these meetings, and so these so-called GAs, the G20s, sort of put together a bit of a map and say, okay, this is what the rules are for this year, this quarter, the century, whatever, however they want to do it. They set up a sort of a generalized plan. But just because they set out the generalized plan doesn't necessarily mean that's what's going to happen. And this is what the case here, that, you know, okay, they agreed upon the general lines of where territories are, how to divide up the world amongst the superpowers, you know. And it's not that they're all in on this conspiracy. Is what happens is they come to a compromise. Okay, we're not going to have continuous war, particularly with nuclear weapons now. So what do we have to do? And invariably, within that plan, usually not even within a few months after the plan is agreed upon, somebody's in there already reneging on the plan or throwing a monkey wrench into the plan, so the whole thing that they initially set up falls apart and something new has to be put together. And that's what the UN negotiations, when you look at, say, well, what does a diplomat do? Oh, they stop wars. Well, no, they're not stopping wars. They're not negotiators. What they're negotiating for is how to divide up the world. They've agreed, okay, yeah, we're all going to form this one single government. So the UN is the one single government that's going to be the New World Order. But what happens is, because not all the countries are on the same page, and you have new players coming in, and some old players going out, the mix and the wants and the needs often change. And so do the dynamics. The dynamics also change. And this is what we're seeing. This is what we're seeing now in the 2012 election. If Donald Trump gets elected, yes, he is part of the so-called establishment, you know, in a very loose way. Because he is not fully on board with what's going on. Hillary Clinton is. Hillary Clinton is in line and step with what's going on. She's with one particular group who wants more war. She is with a very hawkish group known as the neocons, basically. And Trump isn't. So what happens is that the neocons have been in there since Clinton. And what happens is if Trump gets elected, the goals of the neocons get shifted into a new sphere. In other words, Donald Trump really does bring about new change. This is why they're going after Donald Trump. They're going after Donald Trump the way he is, the way they are. And what are they doing for Donald Trump? This is not what they're doing in terms of Hillary. Hillary, they're doing as much as they can to hide all bad stuff. But there's so much there, it's just dripping out. It's dripping, you know, they can't contain everything. So basically, Hillary, it's a process of containing and damage control for all of the different bad things that she's been involved in, including Holocaust, including genocide. And, you know, she's got so much negative stuff. Now that even with WikiLeaks, the recent revelation, but this is sort of, what's in WikiLeaks is not necessarily new information. It's confirmation of things that the people sort of thought of before. They've made loose connection. Okay, Clinton's involved in child pornography. He's involved in pedophilia. Well, now some of the links to this are now starting to come out in WikiLeaks. And so a lot of the initial insinuations have another new area of confirmation. So you're now starting to get independent confirmation of various different ideas of they call them scams. They're not necessarily scams. This is evil behavior. They're preying on innocent people. But with Donald Trump, this isn't the case. Donald Trump isn't hemorrhaging. He's not hemorrhaging these particular problems. What's happening with Donald Trump is they're finding anything. And this is what we'll talk about. I'll be talking about in a new Tweetland Plus. Hillary Clinton, the real butcher of Syria, last night. And I did this at the end of basically 14-15 hours of solid research, so, and I found some new stuff in there, and it's, you know, and it is, some of my sources are from Czechoslovakia, some of them are, come from, and provide good information from deep inside the Ukraine, And they're not necessarily not sources that I know. It's just what happens is this bits and pieces that are sort of floating up there, and I collect this thing. It happened to be in my net, and, well, there it is. And so, Hillary Clinton's got this particular rape culture going on, and the rape culture is that is the way women are treated in society as a standard, as a general behavior. And young men do tend to not consider the feelings and the feelings or the proper treatment of girls, of women, of females. They view them as objects, they view them as something to be pursued, something to be gained, something to won. And particularly, they're looking at the sexual appetite. And in this case here, sexual appetite, if you look at the psychology of it, more often than not, ends up being psychological abuse. Sex is actually abusive. Even when the girl says yes, she wants this, there are a variety of different conditions in there that where the consent is not necessarily, that might not be what she really wants. There's a positive psychological condition that they a reward. So, someone wants to have sex with this girl. Maybe she doesn't have enough money for food, so she says yes, so that she can get something to eat. That's the reward, right? She's not saying yes because she wants to have sex. She's saying yes because she wants to eat. She's hungry, right? She doesn't have the money for food, you know, or a good place to live. So this is why she's saying yes. It's not a yes to sex, it's a yes, I want something to eat. And this is sort of a life condition. The other life condition, which is more of a negative life condition, sort of a negative conditioning, actually. Because that can be argued, the other one, you know, having sex for money for food, is a sort of a positive condition. She's getting something positive out of it. But it is indeed itself negative, and you'll see how we'll work up this in this. The negative example. The negative example would be, she's been held captive, and she knows that if she doesn't perform properly, you know, to the man's satisfaction, that the people who own her will beat her up or kill her. In other words, she's saying yes to avoid physical harm, and that's the negative condition. So yes, each one is life threatening. And not necessarily the best, not a good position to be in, but one is more negative than the other in the immediate. And so this is the situation that we find a lot of girls in, particularly around popular people. You see, they want to be popular. They think the guys like them. The guys tell them they like him, and most of the girls will think, oh yeah, he's going to be my boyfriend, he's going to be my husband, and they plan out a whole life ahead of them. And so the girls are going in with that mindset. They're not going in, oh, I'm just going to be random with this guy. And so what ends up happening is that the guy, in this assumption that this is the way girls work, he sees only the superficially, he doesn't see the mindset behind it, will go in and say, oh yeah, she wants it. And the thing is, their locker room discussion, the guys, when they talk amongst themselves, these are the standard guys, will often talk about their conquests. And of course, these conquests are girls. And this is a standard for guys. So if you have someone, they are a standard guy. In their youth, between the ages of 15 and 25, they were part of conquests. This is the rape culture, the conquest of the girl, the conquest of sex, is the rape culture. And Hillary had her chance with Monica Lewinsky and a lot of these other different events that have occurred with Bill Clinton. She had her chance to stand up. She had her chance to stand up as a defense lawyer when she was defending a pedophile. And in each case, along the way, you can see case after case, she backed down, didn't stand up for the victim, and instead protected the predator. And then she turns around and calls herself a feminist. Well, ironically enough, the feminists do the exact same thing. when Monica Lewinsky was being abused in the White House, the feminists said nothing. When you had a Supreme Court nominee, Clarence Thomas, he made remarks in his past. They brought up tiny little remarks and said, "Oh, there he goes. He's a sexist. He's a pig. He shouldn't. He's a misogynist to get women. He shouldn't be elected to the Supreme Court." Clinton is actually involved in doing things. Someone says something, that's when they protest. Same thing with Donald Trump. Donald Trump has said things in his past, and they bring that up. That's their horror. Donald Trump is a misogynist. He's a pig. He's a sexist. He's dangerous for women. Why? Because he said things in the past. Yet Bill Clinton, who has actually done it, he's actually got the physical track of a predator. Not the stated fact, like, you know, oh, he's a predator. He talks about women, right? No, okay. That's Donald Trump, right? That's their response to Donald Trump. Bill Clinton, on the other hand, has actually had records of rape, assault, and so on and so forth, and there's no comment on it whatsoever. This is the feminist stance to this day. One wouldn't be surprised to understand if you sit down and look at feminism, that it comes from the left. It's a leftist view, it's a leftist behavior, and it stands right in line with the people who believe in an open sexual society, who are also on the left. So, this is Hillary Clinton. This is Hillary Clinton in a nutshell, basically. And she's along with all these UN people who are all involved in these different things, and Donald Trump isn't. And what Donald Trump represents is he represents a new view on how things should be done. And he is the monkey wrench. No, regardless of his negatives, if you sit down and actually look at these things and do the research, the deep level research, you'll see that he is the monkey wrench. He doesn't bring in a lot of change, but his potential. He brings in enough change. And this is the way I'll phrase this. He brings in enough change that it throws a monkey wrench into the current standard New World Order. In other words, the current standard for this New World Order that under the Clintons, he really messes that up. And this is why you're seeing what you're seeing in the news. This whole thing with Loretta Lynch, the rigging of the elections. This is all about cementing this view that they have that how the world should be run. And this is the UN actually working behind this. So it's not just Hillary Clinton. This is the UN isn't actually behind this. So you've got the UN, Clinton, on one side, and you have Donald Trump by himself on the other side. So what type of change do you want? Do you want the status quo with more war? Or do you want to take a chance on Donald Trump, who really does represent a change? He's the monkey wrench. This is why they're so frustrated with him, because he should have died a long time ago. He should have not be up there. But yet, people are so fed up with what the current standard is. They want something different, no matter what it looks like. And unfortunately for Clinton, Donald Trump does indeed represent change. Now, I don't know whether this is going to get out on time for the election, but probably not, because we're a little bit behind on the vlogs, but it doesn't matter. The election is simply one point in time. If Donald Trump is changed, then there's a way for groups, for individuals to get involved, to make sure that change moves in a positive direction. And that's kind of what I'm doing here. Part of the research of what I'm doing here, yeah, I could sit there and do this stuff for myself, but I realize I'm in the world. And if I have an ability to affect the world around me in a better, positive direction, and that's what I should do. And that's what I'm doing. So I am trying to make a change, trying to make things better. I have to do the long research, and sometimes it's 15 to 20 hours or even more. Sometimes it lasts for days, and I'm only taking breaks in between to have, maybe 3-4 hours of sleep here and there. That's the way things are. Then this is why I can't do a daily vlog. The schedule is not consistent enough for me to do a daily vlog. I mean, if you have a day that lasts, and you're doing this research project, and that project that you're working on takes 4 or 5 days. It takes an entire week to finish that project. That's your one day. So one day spans five, one work day actually spans 5 days. You can't do a daily vlogging like that if you have that 5 day thing. Then all of a sudden you have basically a 12-hour day, right? So you have a long day, then you have a short day. Can't do daily vlogging like that. So that's why we are where we are right now. So I'm going to leave this here for now, because I need to do a little bit more filming. And then we'll go from here. It's time for breakfast at just about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. And, yeah, got 1 hour left on the camera before the memory card, the memory chip is actually filled up. Alright, I'll see you in the next segment of Big Bang Theory Hour's BTS Vlog.
I am the professor. And professor of what? Professor of physics.
Oh, say, can you see?
Speech rules here at Democratic Earth.